So we're going to be changing directions a little bit with our next speaker. So next up is going to be David Barroso from Countercraft. So as I said in my intro, a lot of my background is actually deception and cyber threat intelligence. And so I'm excited about this. MITRE and ATT&CK talks a lot about detections and mitigations. We believe there are other possible responses that ATT&CK doesn't cover. So, you know, with deception adversary engagement being near and dear to my heart, give a nice welcome to David.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Thank you also for organizing such an awesome conference. It's great to be here with you today. So today we are going to talk about how we can map some attack techniques to some engage activities. And we'll explain what MITRE Engage is. So, but before starting, I want to say send a big kudos to the MITRE Engage team because they are doing a fantastic job. Actually, they did a very good presentation last week at the SMUCon here in Washington, D.C. So I recommend you to watch that presentation where they were showing how they were doing some operations, in this case with HSBC, the bank. So real operations, trying to engage with adversaries. So I recommend you to watch that video. It's very, very awesome. And also go to the website of MITRE Engage. Yesterday I was saying that I felt a lot of pressure because I was talking about MITRE Engage at a MITRE conference inside the MITRE building. No? So I will try to do my best, try to say how MITRE Engage is really cool. And we'll try to show some examples of how can we use Engage for engaging with activities with adversaries. So before starting, just a quick intro about MITRE Engage. So MITRE Engage appeared like some months ago, but the latest version, that the official version was on February this year. So uses cyber denial and cyber deception as foundations or pillars of trying to engage with threat actors. So that's the main goal, try to engage with threat actors. And for that also, we need to think not only about technical stuff, but also about planning and analysis. And for me, that's something really good that they did when trying to create this Engage framework, because it's not always about technical stuff. It's always about planning and also trying to analyze what's happened so that we can reuse this information for improving our operations with adversaries. So, of course, there are procedures when trying to engage with attackers. And I guess that there are three main goals that Engage is trying to state. The first one is how can we get a high fidelity alerts or try to detect threat actors as soon as possible. The second one would be, how can we impose cost to the adversary? And you know that there is a lot of discussions around Twitter about imposing cost, but I think that's a good idea and a good way to express that. And the third one would be, how can we collect as much as intelligence from the attackers so that we can use that intelligence with other tools or the products for sharing with peers? So something that, how can we collect that kind of information? And for that, they have created, based on a lot of military stuff, because as we know, deception comes from the military, they have created this 10-step process where, as you can see, the yellow ones are more about planning and analyze, and only the blue ones are about technical stuff. So we need to focus a lot on planning. So trying to answer those questions and to prepare those different steps from knowing your enemy. If you remember that good article from the Hornet Project, you know, in 20 years ago, a lot of time ago. So from knowing your adversary to, for instance, one of my favorites is trying to determine step number 6, the success and gating criteria. When do we need to stop? It's because we have collected enough intelligence. It's because the threat actor has noticed that this is a deception scenario. So you need to define very clearly those steps so that the output and the success of the operation will depend on the answers and the preparations in this preparation plan. And then you can execute the operation and then train to understand what happened. How can you extract raw intelligence that you can share with products or third parties, as I said. So Engage also has different terms that are similar to ATT&CK. For instance, we have approaches and activities. Approaches are tactics from the same meaning that in ATT&CK, and activities are techniques in ATT&CK. But they decided to use different terms because then we cannot, it's easy to differentiate if we are talking about Engage or talking about ATT&CK. But also they have something more in the top of the matrix, that is the goals. So we have different goals, we can see preparation, expose, affect, elicit, and then understand. So those are main goals that can be different strategic or for engagement goals. So these are the key terms. And as we can see, also we have a matrix similar to attack, where we can see the yellow ones that are the strategic goals from preparation to then to the end, to the last one, that is how can we understand everything that happened. And we can see the different approaches and activities from planning, of course, and how can we define many and answer many of those questions that we were seeing at the beginning of those 10-step processes. So like the gating criteria, if we need to create personas for our narrative, storyboarding that's also one of my favorites. We need to create a narrative so that then we can have an opportunity to engage with the adversary. And then we have the last one is analyze. No? And we can, of course, try to reuse and feed everything that we have found to our threat model, or perhaps we can use the information that we are getting for improving our defenses, or sending everything to the SOC, to the blue team, so that they can be prepared for the next wave of attacks coming from the same threat actor. So I think that's really cool. And then also we have the technical stuff, the blue one. So where we need to first expose threat actors, we need to try to affect them, and then we need to collect or elicit information from them. So as you can see, we have different activities or techniques from attack. So activities that we can use for trying to collect information, how can we force them to make mistakes so that we can collect even more information, or perhaps how can we try to confirm that they are like in a real scenario, and so that we force them to think that they are in a real scenario, not in a deception scenario. So as we can see, different activities from network manipulation, security controls, I don't know, deploying vulnerable applications in specific networks could be changing the security controls of an application, malware detonation. The SMUCON presentation was about that, one of the use cases, how HSBC was detonating malware from Fin7, the threat actor group, so that they can collect like a second stage payloads that for them was really important to collect them. But then, of course, we can use lures that all will be the classic decoys, like those machines that we are deploying so that we can collect more information. And I think it's important also to reassure. We need to make everything credible. So credibility is key. And also try to make everything as credible as possible so that the more credible the scenario is, the more time the adversary will be gathering around and playing around and messing around with our scenarios. So those are the different activities and approaches. The question would be, okay, so we know now the Engage framework. How can we map all the attack techniques to those Engage activities? So the Mitel Engage has done an incredible job trying to start mapping those techniques to activities. So for instance, what they are doing is, okay, we have attack technique X, so we can map this to this activity from Engage. So for instance, like a very quick example, attack technique could be like using RDP, remote system discovery. And then what we can do is try to deploy some lures so that the attacker will find those remote services that we have published in the internet. And then we can extract information from the attacker after they log in into those systems, they collect information, deploy their tools. So we can collect not only TTPs, but also IOCs from the attacker. Also, just two quick examples. The first one, Team TNT. I don't know if you know about Team TNT. They are gone in words of one of their members. Used to be like an active group that were doing a lot of stuff in the internet. So imagine that we are an organization and we want to check if we know that TNT is targeting us because, I don't know, they like to target our sector. And we have lots of Docker daemons connecting to the internet. And we want to try to check if they are trying to scan our networks and do something. And then SSH from the container itself to the host through SSH, so that then they will be a root in the host. So that's what they are doing. So we can try to map everything to Engage. So if we know that TNT is doing this type of techniques, then we can know which type of activities from Engage we can do. So for instance, putting some lures, also try to change the security controls of those Docker daemons so that they can be easily compromised without authentication, for instance. So we can play a lot with different activities so that we can collect more and more information from this attacker. Another quick example, the infamous Log4j vulnerability. So imagine that also we have lots of vulnerable machines in the internet that we cannot patch because whatever reason. And we want to check if someone is trying to exploit them and also what they do after exploiting them. So in this case, it's very easy. As we check one of those Log4j incidents, we know that people are just scanning. Could be a threat actor that is specifically scanning our organization. It could be a random attacker. Then exploits the system. Then, for instance, in this case, they install PowerShell scripts, execute them, download the second stage binary, and do a lot of different stuff. In this case, for instance, at the end, they are going to install a crypto miner. That could be a normal use case. So what we are doing is trying to map everything to engage activities. And again, what we can do, what can we do for trying to detect those activities and then collect information about attackers? So engage is for that. So we can then deploy some lures, create different network diversity, like different applications, different Java versions, different, I don't know, using struts or Tomcat, anything. So we can easily play with that kind of information. Finally, some engagement tips, like something that we've been playing a lot with Engage during the last time. So for instance, some engagement tips. So we can deploy different types of services and systems in order to attract attackers from a vulnerable system, non-vulnerable systems, credentials in a page bin pointing to a web server or to SSH or to our RDP. So we can play with different type of breadcrumbs. And then we can also play with attackers trying to do kind of a bait and switch. So trying to impose cost, trying to create confusion among them, or trying to delay their actions or force them to make mistakes so that we can collect more information. So for instance, a very good example is imagine that we detected APT28 in our networks. We can deploy APT29 IOCs and TTPs in the same network so that APT28 will see that APT29 is also in the same network, and they will create a lot of confusion and chaos against that back in their office. So that's an example, but many others. How can we try to play and impose cost to all the attackers? And that's pretty much everything. So, well, thank you very much.
Thank you so much. You know, adversary engagement is a very interesting topic that a lot of us, including myself, are just starting to really understand all the nuance of. So thank you. I think we have time for one quick question. If there's anyone, oh, right here. So just to repeat the question for the live audience, how do you deal with the legality of adversary engagement, especially when thinking of terms like hack back and, you know, are you playing in red space and gray space, blue space? What are your thoughts there?
So that is a good question. I guess that there is a very broad spectrum between like a passive defense to active defense. And then we have, I think, hack back. So hack back is only for law enforcement or military. So I guess that we are totally very far away from hacking back. But active defense where you can run operations against your adversaries, like I don't know, the ones that we've been saying, like deploying things on the internet so that we can study and collect information, detect the activity. I think that's totally legal. You are not doing anything illegal. But hacking back is only for law enforcement or military.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great presentation.
Thanks. Bye.